this morning we are blessed to have one of our missionaries that we support as a church here visiting with us, Dino Tuttle, has been supported by this church for much longer than I have served in this congregation. So he is going to share the word with us this morning. He has a song he wrote and he wants to share with us as well, perhaps. And we're going to learn about him and his ministry. Dino, do you want to stand on the floor and use a music stand? Do you want to have a pulpit? I don't know where you want to.
Does that kind of community?
This works too, yep.
Man, is it good to be back here? How many remember meeting in the basement of the bank? Ah. I didn't do that long. Hallelujah. It's good to be here. It's just good to be here. We miss Lawrence Amundsen. He was a friend of mine. The Lord just really did us together. He came down to see us a couple times in Alamo, and
just
need
to hold it. Okay. Also, came down to see us. Pizza, and we were very low budget then. We tried to give them soda. That's we call it pop. Okay, every week, and we'd have something like maybe popcorn, and that. But it was just nice. We had a good time together, and we appreciated that. We still remember that, and. You know, and this church has just backed us from the beginning. We've been down there a long time. I come up to see old friends, so anyway, it gets so weird. We don't really know how to present ourselves in English. We live where we speak English and Spanish, but we speak in the same sentence. So forgive me if I say something you don't know, just raise your hand and I'll get it to you. Bob?
Yeah.
Can you play this on the, it's D, A, and G. I've translated a lot of songs, but the Lord has given me some songs. This one came in Spanish, but it was so easy to put in English, so I put it in English also. So let's see.
Thank you.
Can you put the? I put a couple pictures on. I had pictures on my camera, and I never thought about it until I was standing here, and there's all of these young people that know how to do all this stuff with the camera, with the computer, and all that kind of stuff. I don't know. I mean, when I was little, telephones had wooden hung on the wall, and they had a crank on the side. I have a hard time with this phone, but whenever I have trouble with my phone, catch a kid, they can fix it. So, this is for soccer. We're into soccer. Down there, it's not called soccer, it's called football. Oh. Football, all right. And so this is the second portería, goal that we got for football. And somebody gave us one, and we got a brother that just started the church probably a year ago, and he gets these packages of things that didn't sell and things like that. And so he got one of those, he gave it to us for our youth center, and it worked so good because, is there another picture on there? I don't know how many pictures you've got on there, so. There was another one of the kids playing with a goal that I had made, one of them. It looks so easy, you just get this plumbing pipe and PVC and you make a goal, and I did, but I don't know if your kids are too rough or I did a too bad job, but it didn't last very long. So they used that on one end and then the two garbage cans on the other. So we make do with what we got. So anyway, then I saw that the just package had come from Walmart. I don't know, if you change the picture, just let me know.
That's a video. I have to go to somewhere else for that.
Oh, okay. That's fine. But now, the Lord put this in my heart, I think about 1985, that the youth center is the start of the whole start and emphasis of the church. We started with the youth center, and when we started, the kids were fighting with bricks and bats and everything right in the intersection. And these little rascals, the cops would come along and they would hide the bricks and bats under our church, and they'd come in and they'd sit like little angels. At least they got to hear the word of God a little bit. But we really didn't win any of the first bunch, but we kept going, and the second bunch with a pool table. Some of these, the Lord blessed us with Regal. He was really big help. When he came, first he came from Mexico and heard the word, and then he had to go back to Mexico, and he called me one day that he was back, and if I could come and pick him up. So I kind of teased him, called him Moses, I picked him out of the river. But anyway... I don't do that a lot, but he started working and he began to win souls. So he brought his friends from work. They worked construction back at that time, $6 an hour for a helper at the construction site, and he started winning these other guys, bring him to church to play pool, and they never would have come if it had not been for the pool table. And so, well, they like pool, and so they came and heard a little bit of the word of God. These three brothers sat there outside because everything, we had the pool table inside, but everything else was out under a little shelter, and we gave them their sodas and whatever cookies or something that we had, and I says, you guys came to this country to earn money, but God had a better purpose for you. God has something really good for your life, and they don't even remember that, but I remember it. So finally they started, and they drank a lot, and these are young guys that are 18, 20, drank a lot, started coming to church, and this one friend, this Pedro, even I'd go visit him and his eyes would be red and all that, because they just drank all the time. And I go visit, even when I go visit him when he was like that, just so friendly, just I felt so good, I felt so welcome. And little by little we went into Jesus, and like Rigo and Pedro are the elders in our church. And they came young. And we put in the work for Jesus. And now the thing that Rigo just got married, he's 47. And he, you know, in our church, it's hard to find a young unmarried girl. You know, we minister to the young men. They're the ones that need it, and they're the ones that are going to be the leaders. And sorry, ladies, but we put our emphasis on the young men. And Rigo had to go online, but he found this wonderful Christian girl in Brownsville. She's really from Matamoros, but she has papers to live in Brownsville and to work in the United States, and so we just married them a couple weeks, a month ago, I guess they got married, and that was a nice wedding. They got married, and these boys have prospered all the time. Pedro, he already had a wife. Well, he had a partner in Mexico, and so I said, hey, it's not good for you guys to be here alone. You know, there's too much stuff that can happen here, and you need to bring your wives. So they listened, and they brought their wives. The two of the brothers brought their wives, and the wives didn't like it here. You know, no family, no, it's hard. And they cried while they were here, but Now we just did I wasn't there. Pedro and Rigo handled a quinceañera. If you don't know what a quinceañera is, it's a girl's 15th birthday party, and it's big. It's big. It's a big event. And so they did it there, and I got the pictures. They did a beautiful job. And Pedro's now a grandfather, so we have a bunch of third generations that are coming to church. His brother Jaime, the grandfather, 2 years ago he became a grandfather, and now his daughter has just had another. Lord brought a wonderful kid from the high school, 16 years old, brought him to church, and he came a couple times, and I want this, and we baptized him. Right that time we baptized a lot of kids from the high school, and so, and now they got a family, and are a lot of young people. I continue contact with a lot of the young people I met in the high school, that now they're showing me pictures of their families, their kids, and all that. But a lot of them should have gone to college, but the oil fields are offering. These kids can go to the oil fields and make $90,000 a year. No college education, hard work. They work 2 weeks. They're off 2 weeks. So, you guys want to make some money? Hey, pump that oil. Okay. That's great. And so, anyway, the Lord is blessing. The Lord is blessing our church. Our adults, the majority of our adults still do not have papers, and as of the laws now, there's very little chance, although Regal's wife is a resident alien, and she has the right to make a petition for him, and so probably eventually Regal is going to have a social security number and papers. Other people, a lady came one day to do, she needed a notary, so she came to me. I'm a notary, and we can't say soy notario público, because that's illegal to say that in Texas, because in Mexico a notary is also a lawyer, and a lot of they're trying to prevent a lot of corruption that has happened for years there. But she needed an notary. She called me up, and I met her there at church, and her and three kids. And the oldest boy, I think, was 17, and he showed a lot of interest, because outside the church, we had the name of the church, but then we had another sign that had the menorah, the Jewish candlestick on the, and he started asking me about it, and I saw interest in him, so I invited him to my house. I said, "Well, come to my house. We have a Bible study, and we've been going over the tabernacle, so this is part of our Bible study." And so he, his mother, his brother, and his sister came to our house and for Bible study, and they came a couple times. Then they even started going to church, and they came. We are not real evangelistic, like, I mean, sit on your face and, hey, this is the way it is. But it takes a while. They came probably 2 years, and finally they had to make a decision that, are you going to stay in the Catholic Church, or do you want this? And they says, we want this. You know, we don't tell anybody to get out of the Catholic Church. We just give them this. And so, anyway, you know what this is? This is what you got. This is what you got. You know what we feel here today? This Holy Ghost moving it. That's what we got. Hallelujah. And these people love the church. I mean, they love the church, and they tell it. Now the uncle, he's about 70 some years old. He came to our church, and he loves the church. He says, I like this church. Even if I have to get baptized, and nobody ever talked to him about baptism, even if I have to get baptized, I want to keep going to that church. And we offered him, and he still hasn't been baptized. But do you know what the Lord did? We had an evangelist come from Mexico, and the Lord uses him to lay hands on people to receive the Holy Ghost. Well, he was there for 3 days, and seven people he laid hands, including this uncle, Tio Chuy. If your name is Jesus, you're probably called Chuy, or if you're more Americanized, you're probably called Jesse. But anyway, Tio Chuy received the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues, you know, and so did, there's a bunch of, you know, seven in that time, including this young man that was interested in the candlestick. He received, because we baptized him, he didn't speak with tongues, and I don't know why he didn't speak with tongues, but he, you know, kept coming, and I tell him, you need the tongues, I don't know how much you're teaching him, but hey, we need to speak in tongues. I mean, we were tongue-speaking people, and a lot of times they try to, yeah, but don't do that all the time. I mean, you have to do that all the time. Yeah, you gotta. You really have to. We're tongue-speaking people. God gave us that. We're not speaking to man. We're speaking to God. Can't understand it? Well, I'm speaking to God. That's why. And anyway, this young man, he also received the Holy Ghost. And another guy who is Peter's brother's stepson. He is a he's got his master's in education from Mexico, but he came, we baptized him a few years ago, but then he went back to Mexico, and I didn't think he was doing really good, but the Lord has really blessed him. He finished his education, he's got a master's of education in Mexico, and he's got papers to cross the bridge. He's only supposed to stay 3 days, but nobody ever checks. So he comes and stays, you know, probably a couple months at a time, and he's really growing in the Lord. He's really growing in the Lord, and this guy's got talent. I mean, he was working for the schools in Mexico, but he has a bigger business of doing weddings and quinceañeras, and weddings are big in Mexico. Weddings are big. Quinceañeras are big, And you know, for a quinceañera, a girl will go spend her padrinos, that's all the people that contribute to this event. And they'll have a dress like a wedding dress, only it won't be white, it'll be pink or blue or something. So he makes money coordinating those. Whenever we have an event at church, Sergio, we're going to do this, and he takes charge. I don't have to do anything, you know, anymore. I didn't even, yesterday, they had the quinceañera, I didn't have to do it, I was here. And so, Lord is raising up leaders. And that's what we have, for years, we tried, these new ones coming in, we tried to give them to minister. To first find what you can do for the Lord. And this one kid, I mean, he just goes to the piano and just starts playing. You know, I mean, but he learned that at church. But he just practices all the time. He can play for a wedding. He can play for a quinceañera. He can play for anything. But we want them to get into, hey, working for the Lord. Hey, this is the kingdom of God, huh? Gotta do something. And I wanted to get them to start preaching and said, hey, just find a verse in the Bible. Hey, you young men too, listen to me. If you find a verse in the Bible that speaks to you, you know, you're reading the Bible every day? Yeah, ooh, start doing that. Find a verse in the Bible that speaks to you and pray about it, meditate on it, and you can get up in church. And I saw this morning, there's room that you can get up here and instead of a prayer request, you can say, hey, I've been reading in the Word, and this verse really is flashing at me, and this is how it works out in my life. And so that's I've been trying, and I never could get him to do it. I could not get him to do it. So we had every week we have a leaders meeting, and I says, Pedro. You know, and he wants, he's been trying to get him to do it too, but he said, hey, you do it. And so after church, he met with four, and he says, one, Pedro's second son just has a gift of words. I mean, in writing, you know, he writes me things on email, and I mean, it just, you know, I mean, I feel so good after, you know, you read what a nice thing that he wrote about. You feel so good. Don't you feel good when somebody writes something nice about you? Anyway, he says, Pedro talked to these kids, and he just has a way of working the kids too. And one of the boys says, well, yeah, I'm ready. I've got something I'd like to say even tonight, because we were going to give them a couple of weeks to, actually they say that a couple of weeks is just for sweating and being nervous, but we were going to give them a couple of weeks to prepare, and I said, oh, I can do it tonight, and he did, but Pedro's second son, Isaac, he says, I just don't know if I can get up there and really express myself before everybody, but I'm praying about it, and I'm reading the Bible, I'm praying about it, and maybe the Lord is just telling me this is the time I need to do it, but he didn't commit himself. So anyway, in the evening, this Pedro was together, he's a different Pedro. We have an abundance of Pedros. he got up, and I mean, hey, you don't have to talk 5 minutes, but he really went on, and he expressed, you know, the change that the Lord had brought in his life. Well, when he started church, he worked in the bar, keeping the shelves stocked. You know, he was, by that time, he was 18, and he could work in the bar, and I think his mother was a waitress there. But the Lord moved him out of there and into different work, and now he's got a pretty good job. But, you know, and no papers. He doesn't have any papers. He came too late to get the DACA. So he doesn't have a social security, but he told the Lord, what the Lord had done in his life since he started coming to the church, and so how much they appreciate the church and how his friends don't understand it, but he just tells them that they need Jesus too. And it was good. And then on Sunday night, we have communion. We have communion every Sunday night, so we're okay. But we have it, we just stand around the table and we spend some time on the bread, we spend time on the cup, and we worship the Lord in that. And then we, anybody got something to say about anybody here got something good you can say about Jesus? And they'll start. And this Isaac, the Pharaoh's second son, man, he went on and on. He just let it out. It really was good. It was a blessing. So, and I think Sergio is going to do it tonight. And it's what I call, it's the beginning of the apostolic youth movement. So, got it. You know, we've been playing with these kids a lot. You know, we have them there. They get there. They set up the soccer goals, and they, you know, we have to keep them on property. We carry them to the next lot because the next lot is not in our name yet. Not even a contract to buy it. But we can use it because we keep it mold. And so they set those up, and they play until they get good and sweaty, and then this lady that needed a notary, she's there cooking, and some other ladies come and help. And we spend a lot of money on food. We really do. But it takes, if we can win a generation, it's a good investment. And so anyway, they'll prepare food, nachos. Our nachos are just not cheese and chips. It's cheese and jalapenos and everything else, lettuce and everything else they put on. Anyway, so we call the kids in and set the food out there, and then we start ministering the word of God to them. And Rigo and I and whoever else, give them something from the word. More than they get if they didn't come to the youth center. And so anyway, and then they fellowship around, they eat and all that. And, then they go out and they more football until I don't know, until they close, I guess. Because I don't stay because I leave early because I have to work on Saturday. I teach an adult class of driver's training. Adult that's 18 and over. Yeah. But don't worry, I've had some that were in their 70s. They go down to the DPS and they can't pass the test, so they come and I teach them how to pass the test. And so anyway, that's what I do on Saturdays. And then 5 days a week, I'm on the road with the teenagers, teaching them to drive. Very good. You know, do I get nervous? No. Do I get impatient? No. Fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering. I got it. Hallelujah. It's interesting. I mean, this one girl, she's a pretty good driver. We're driving a lot. We come to this big intersection, Jackson Road and Ridge Road. Big intersection. And so she's driving along real good. And just before we get to the crosswalk, the light turns yellow. So what does she do? She slams on the brakes. So we stop in the middle of the intersection. Go, go, go. Because I got an extra brake. I don't have an extra gas pedal. So go, go. And she looks at me so sweet. She says, but the light's red. Yes, now it is. You're blocking traffic. So that's my exciting story. Another one. That's cool. If I haven't bored you, the Lord's been speaking to me. Can I give a message? This is what the Lord has been speaking to me about, some verses that I saw. We all, Some of you are farmers. Some of you know how to maybe put a bit in the horse's mouth to just so you can not to be mean to the horse, just to show him which way you want to go, right? And James, it says that you put a bit in the horse's mouth to be able to turn him whatever way you want to go. Do you know that your tongue is 100% flesh? Do you know that? There's not a bone in it. Check it. There's not a bone in it. In the Bible, in James, it also says, who can control the tongue? But do you know what I'm seeing in that is that helping us to put a bit in our mouth that we can control that tongue, but to use it for your benefit. If you got a horse, they're not much good around here if you don't have, you don't go horseback riding, you don't have a plow for them to pull. They're not much good just standing around the barn. So I'm not a very good farmer, but I know that's what you do. But the Lord has spoken to me that we can use this tongue. We can get this tongue in control to use it for our benefit. For our benefit. To produce for you. And here's the words from Proverbs. Proverbs 12:14. If you're taking notes, a man will be satisfied with good by the fruit of his tongue, and the recompense of a man's hands will be rendered to him. The fruit of your tongue. This, I saw that in there in the Bible. Fruit of your tongue. Right across the page, Proverbs 13:2, a man shall eat well by the fruit of his mouth. And then Proverbs 18, this one, I'm sure. A man's stomach will be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth. From the produce of his lips he shall be filled. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. And that's what I saw that. And those that love it. Love what? Love what? Love the power of the tongue. Love the power of the tongue. We can use, and the Lord has been dealing with me on this, showing me that we can use this tongue to produce for us. The Lord has shown me some things I've got to produce with my tongue. And I don't have any other way of producing it. So, using my tongue. Talking to the Lord, yeah. I'm not talking about praying. I'm talking about using the tongue to produce what the Word of God says. We have all been giving, and I've told some people that I live by what I give. I don't live by what people give me. I live by what I give. Well, I know that you've all had that experience. And the thing is, a lot of times we give, and we give, and we give, and we think, am I seeing any fruit? Am I seeing any fruit of what I'm giving? Is it producing for me? You're sowing, how do you harvest? And the thing that the Lord has been showing me is it's the power of the tongue that we can use to bring the harvest. By stating the Word of God, by saying the Word of God. For instance, Luke 6:38, give and it will be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. And then in 2 Corinthians 9, it says, so let each man give as he proposes in his heart, not grudgingly, nor of necessity. Hey, God's not poor. Lights aren't going to go out if I don't give. So anyway, not of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make, this is the one that I've been stating, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, so that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, you may have abundance for every good work. You know, God is, the harvest is there. The harvest is there from the, what you have done in the past, what you're doing today. The harvest is there. I can't remember which book it said. One of the little books says that the reaper will overtake the sower. You know that we're living in a day that God is moving. We're living in revival days. This is revival. Did you see the video, the Jesus Revolution? Yeah, it's happening again. It's happening again. We were there. We were there back in those days. We remember. It was good. It was. It was good. You don't remember. You weren't even born yet. But it was good. I mean, we would walk down the streets. I'll tell you, especially if you had a Bible in your hand, you'd walk down the street and some nun would stop you and ask you if you knew about the Holy Ghost. And I had the personal experience. And, you know, I mean, it didn't matter what church you went to, the Lutheran church, the Methodist church, not so much the Baptist church, but the Presbyterian, the Episcopal church, God was filling people with the Holy Ghost right and left, and they were having coffee parties, talking about the Bible, and the Lord just really moved. It was a great time. It's coming again. It's here again. It's here again. And we're experiencing a little bit of it. We seem to be the far corner of the country, and I was ministering a lot in Mexico, but I wasn't afraid of any of the things that were happening, because they were happening all around when I was going to Veracruz every month. But the work that I was doing there just ended. And so I don't have any I still am communicating, but it ended. So, but then as soon as it ended, I mean, as soon as the Lord just closed the door to really go back and do it, as soon as it ended, I found out, hey, they're asking about that old guy that comes every month. Tell us about that. Who's that old guy? Does he have any money? And that was the time where they were kidnapping people, holding them for ransom, and chopping off their fingers just to prove they had them. I never had any problem. I went down, stuff was happening all around. As I was coming back from Veracruz one day in the city Soto La Marina, the person who was running for governor of Tamaulipas was going to give a speech. I passed through there an hour before that. An hour after I passed through, they assassinated the guy, and then it was total chaos. I was already on my way, so I never had any problem. The Lord bless me, and if I really felt the Lord wanted me to go back, well, it's no problem. But the thing is, He's bringing them here. He's bringing them here. We got to win those people. I don't know how many of these, they call them migrants, it's a nicer word. Anyway, they call them migrants that are coming 20,000 at a time. Trying to barricade, hitting the border, and they don't want to stay in the valley. I mean, they don't want to stay where we live. They want to get up to Minneapolis or Chicago, because they've heard that the streets are paved with gold up there, and Governor Abbott's sending a lot of them to New York, and they don't like that, and a lot of them to other places, but anyway, that's not really affecting us. If it does, we'll do everything we can to win them to Jesus, but it really hasn't affected us. the ones that have affected us are the ones that have come from Chiapas. There's been a lot of people in Alamo, where I live. There are a lot of people from Chiapas. A little bit hard to win because they're clannish. They're they're descendants of the Mayans. When the Spanish came, they went up to the mountain. They went up the mountain, and they speak. The men speak. Spanish, but somewhat. But they have their dialect, so too. For a while, our church was trilingual. We would sing, every once in a while, we'd sing a chorus in English. Most of it was in Spanish, but then we would have music and a little bit of testimonies in so too, because the women from Chiapas, I don't know Spanish. They don't go to school. They are very paid. They can make a soup that you would love, but they don't know how to read or write or anything like that. But man, they make tortillas and whip them out. Anyway, so we've had, that was one of the big ministries for a while. And now the one that was really leading that, you know, you can't, you know, have you heard the TV? They said the border's closed. So anyway, this guy that was such a blessing in our church had a chance to go to Georgia where his brothers lived. And I said, but it's dangerous. You know, there's a checkpoint north of us. You know, and he said, no, Lord's in it. And Lord was in it. He got through. I don't know how. He got through. And then I don't know if you heard, a little over a month ago, there was 2,800 people that just crashed the border at Brownsville. They just crossed the river, 2,800 of them at once. And this guy had been with us for like 2 years, and you know, really longing for his wife, talking to her every day on the phone, which is nice nowadays, you've got a telephone. Talking to his little kids, and they miss their daddy. And of the 2,800 people, three of them were his wife and two kids. And we don't promote it, but I'm glad they got through. I mean, some of these others, they really need to check, but I'm glad they got through. And the Border Patrol didn't know what to do with them, so they just let them go. They sent them up to, I guess they gave them a ride up to Houston. And they put them up in a hotel overnight, and the next day they're, I think, on a bus going to Georgia. And so the family is reunited in Georgia, which that's nice. I mean, our country shouldn't run that way, but that's nice. Praise the Lord for what happened. So anyway, well, I guess I talked too much. So does anybody have any questions? I mean, we live down there on the border. I mean, it's a lot of news going on, but don't believe anything you hear on the news. Watch Flashpoint, you'll see what's really happening. But anyway, so. Well, if not, Brother David George, I thank you for the opportunity to be here. And
yes, for sure.
Lord bless you. We always thinking about the church and other people. So, Lord bless you.
Let's give Dino a hand. Your God isn't a northern God. He's not a southern God. Back in the day, they used to think maybe he's the God of the hills, so we'll try to fight the Israelites in the valleys. And realized, no, that didn't work either. You know, the same God that ministers to our needs up here, ministers to the needs of the people right down on the border. It's just wonderful hearing the testimonies from Dino, how the Holy Spirit is moving, acting, and how there's been three generations of impact now. That is just a testimony to the ministry that we've been supporting down there. So we have a box out on the back table. The Lord has put it on your heart to give. We're going to collect that and relay that on to Dino this morning. Let's just close in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, that wherever we are on the planet, we can be your people, and we can be agents of influence for your kingdom. We can be winning those who are around us.
Mm-hmm.
We just thank you, Father, for the testimonies of how your Holy Spirit is working through Dino and the people that he's been ministering to for several generations now. And we just pray, Father, you continue that. You'd be continuing to increase his effectiveness and his impact on his community, the families, and their lives. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would be just blessing him financially, providing for all of the food that they hand out, the food that they give out as the gatherings. And we pray, Father, that you would provide for that lot to be theirs in title, not just
yes.
in maintenance.
Yes.
We pray, Father, that they would be able to get a permanent soccer field there, that they leave the goals in place. In Jesus' name we pray.